that they will say, just can't afford to miss this bonding thing. It's just too interesting. There's so much gets exchanged in that first half an hour, right? That it determines the day course of the day. If I'm not there, I miss the day. I look like a loner all day because I missed action. Action got over. We have this 15 minutes call we do at 9 o'clock every day because we are a distributed company. People are in 13 different locations and we have, you know, things like work from home and etc. etc. We don't have offices, we don't believe in the concept of office in the first place. So we say work from, so somebody says, where do I work from? We say, you figure that out yourself, right? I mean, 30-year-old person, 25-year-old person, I have to tell him where to work from, right? So you could decide which government will come and those kind of all things, and right, and you can figure out very well where do you want to work from today. It can be your home, it can be your college, wherever you studied, it can be your canteen, whatever, or nearby barista, cafe, coffee, tea, sit wherever and work, right? So we leave those kind of decisions to people so that they start taking those decisions, they start figuring out how's it to be working from home versus working from barista, working from cafe, coffee, tea, working from somewhere else. How are these things different? Which is better? Which is not good? We want them to learn these things, right? They're supposed to be decision makers. So how, if they don't take any decision only, then how will they become decision makers? If every decision right from where they'll work from I'm going to take, right, then what are they going to do? So we leave it small things to them. How they want to dress up, right? Do I want to tell them how do you want to dress up? So somebody feels motivated wearing jeans, very well wear it. So, understanding what motivates people is a starting point. It will help you draw your course in terms of how you want to build an organization. That also sets the tone for, like I said, growing. You talk about so much about training, etc., right? Now you mark somebody absent for, you know, half a day because he came 15 minutes late. And then you make him sit in a training program now after that, so where he's learning good things. You think he's thinking about good things at that moment at all? Yeah? He's not. He's thinking about resume. So that's what he's going to think about. All your training money is waste. At that day, nothing is going to work. You've lost him. First 15 minutes only, you lost the rest of the day, which was very much yours, right? He had come all the way to work only. These are things which a lot of times we don't worry about. We don't worry about that because we are so much caught up in our own things. We are so much caught up about being an owner, right? We don't realize who's the owner. Right? We were the owner when we founded the business. The owner of the business scaling up plan is the team, not you. You will never be able to scale. It's only the team which can scale it for you. They are the owners, not you. Right? You are only helpers. You can help them achieve it. Or you can deter them. So when you do things like cut salary, do this, this, you're actually deterring them. You're demotivating them all the while. So everyone, this is my belief, everyone starts their day in the morning motivated. They have decided that day they are going to create outcomes. And then after that, these are circumstances which demotivate them. And they decide somewhere in the day that, okay, forget it. Right? Well, as founders and as entrepreneurs, we have to ensure that we are not one of the cause for that, right? We should be able to make sure that whatever time that person has available to contribute that day, right, he is going to do that effectively, no matter what time is left. And there are people who can produce miracles in 2 hours, trust me. And there are people who can sit with you in office for 10 hours and actually just drink coffee, you know, raise your bills, nothing else. You don't want that. So that is important. So we take variety of things in Flagita. We can take a quick, break in the sense from monologue and check if you have questions. If anything related to this, we can quickly take that. And, you know, so ask anything if you want to or share a thought or disagree on any of this.
When you're looking for your team, what are the qualities that you look for? There would be some qualities that you look for in your potential employee.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. So it's got a lot to do with which stage of business you are. Startups should hire differently. Grown-up companies should hire differently. And the difference largely lies in how much of competency dependence you have and how much of cultural fit you want. So for when you are, let's say, hiring in your startup team, in startup team, your own ability to give a clear thought around how career is going to grow, how roles is going to be, will be limited. There are a lot of things you only don't know. So when we started 4 years ago and we were hiring, I remember the second guy who came, right? He was asking questions to which I had no answers, right? And I told him at one point that, hey, listen, I'm setting this business to find these answers only, right? So if I knew it, it already would be existing knowledge and there would be people running this business already, and there's nobody running this business right now. We are the first one thinking about it. There's a very high chance that there's no such business that like this, and we might fail. There's a very high chance. I don't know the answers, but I think there is an opportunity out there. I'm already in it. Want to come in? Come. It's risk. It's lower than what my risk was, because you will still get some salary, right? But chances of failure are equal for both of us. Right? So that stage is very different compared to, let's say, today when somebody comes in, I am able to clearly tell him where are we going in next 3 to 5 years. What is this year's operating plan? What is this quarter's operating plan? What is going to be his deliverables and what will be measured after 3 months, right? So today's scenario is very different from that day. Irony is, today people don't ask those questions. So they read about us on whatever sites, etc., etc. And every time I ask them, you have any question, this and that, they say, no, we have read about everything. You know, so when you have information, nobody wants to know. Right. But at startup level, you need different sets. You know, it's more of a culture fitment, it's more of ability to multitask. It's somebody who's going to do the job, but is also going to manage uncertainty. Right, that skill is important, right? Who's not going to feel jittery all the time, right? And not get uncomfortable if the role changes a little bit, because in startup team, roles will change. Whereas if you are hiring for scaling up, you want somebody who's more focused on core business, who's not coming with an ambition that his role is going to keep changing every now and then, and there is a lot of play available in that, because that's what you want to achieve, right? Scale up plan. But while hiring is a big subject, right? And there are no rules about a lot of these things. Whatever I'm sharing is also because they have worked for me in some sense, right? So there's no hard and fast rules in people management, right? But these are some of the ground things you can kind of carry with you. When people join in, they join in people, and as a startup, you are the one reflecting your company's whatever thought. So there is very high chance that at a startup level or early stage level, people are joining you actually. You can, so your name could have been whatever, right? I could have called it HR plug. It had made no difference to the guy who was joining in. He joined because I was talking and he was seeing me and he was making a judgment about how likely is this guy really going to achieve what he's talking. That was the measure. So while I was evaluating him, he was evaluating me constantly. For a lot of early stage entrepreneurs, that is the game. That will you be able to excite the guy or a person who you are interviewing to join you? And is the person going to really believe on your story? So either you carry credentials, or your story is so appealing, or it connects with what he wanted to do himself. Okay. Whatever it may be, right? Early call is confidence on you. That will play a large role in your ability to hire. Once you've grown to a certain stage, the game shifts to your managers. That are they the ones on whom the game shifts to either managers or it shifts to the brand. Both play a role. So if your brand has become strong, it will ease the job for managers. Managers will have to do little convincing because brand has done the convincing. If your brand is still weak, then manager has to do the job. Manager has to really convince that this is a big story and there's a lot of excitement in being here. That's where your so there are a lot of influencing factors which can play a role at a large scale. It can be your brand, it can be your community voice, like people who have worked with you earlier, and what do they say about you once they've gone out. If they're saying good things, it's a positive reference. In today's networked, internet-based environment, it's easy for people to do due diligence. So, you know, a lot of people who come to us, I get surprised by how much they know about us. And, you know, I mean, they know everything. They know, you know, our team members' education background, a lot of them know my family details, a lot of them know what jobs my parents used to do. And very young guys, you know, and so they are very smart, they can dig out things. Some of them also cite me stories from some blogs, etc., here and there, which I would have written or something spoken about. That's the due diligence you are, you know, exposed to all the time. And that plays an important role, so influencing factors. Those things you might want to control. So how many are...
So you're saying the due diligence should be checked?
Yeah, I mean, you need to... what I'm saying is the influencing factor.
Okay, influencing.
Candidate will do due diligence. And he will check around, you know, about what's the company like. And so people who contribute to that content can be your people who have worked with you before. And, so if the internet is filled with people who are talking that this happened to me, that happened to me, it will cause a concern. And so positive word will help.
So can we just have a brief intro, like as in what fields are
each one? Yeah, that's what I was asking. What kind of business are we running here?
I am Manoj, we run a consulting company from Chengdu.
Okay.
I am Sunny and I'm from Envish. We are into software solutions.
Okay.
My name is Sakshi from Envish Solutions. We are my consulting company and I'm into business development.
Okay. I'm from Anonix and we are into software
development. I am Spike.
He's about to retire from him now. I have dragged him to the entrepreneur world.
That's good. What do you do?
I'm a student for now.
Okay.
And I'm looking forward to the entrepreneur world.
Sure. Where are you studying?
I'm studying in Ratanbara.
Okay.
That's engineering college here.
Hi, I'm Shitaj. I'm running an organization which is into counseling of students, career counseling.
Okay. Good. You got a student counselor?
I'm Geeta. I'm partner with a firm, Universal Legal. I'm looking after the Chandigarh office.
Universal Legal?
Yeah.
Okay.
Namni Chut. Namni Chut, right?
Yeah.
He's the firm's partner.
Yeah.
Sharanya is a good friend.
Yeah,
of
okay, alright. Hello, sir. I'm Rikzin. I'm working with Geeta ma'am.
Okay.
Yeah, this is Deepak. I'm an intern at TIE.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Mehta. I'm a student. I'm Riyatan
Bhara.
Where?
Riyatan
Bhara.
I'm
an engineer.
Same college. Myself, Deepak. I'm working with Trinity. The company is all about campus station training.
Okay.
So we give trainings to the final year students for the campus hirings, as well as we give assistance to the colleges for grant promotion.
Okay.
Finishing
the
software.
Yeah,
yeah. So you guys are partners?
No.
After the talk.
Yeah. I'm Kulvinder Singh. I'm in the financial sector. I'm planning and advising.
Okay. People still are taking financial advice?
Yes. They have started paying.
Yeah. They lost money on free advices, so they didn't realize now.
They
better pay and...
People made money.
Yeah.
And they are paying now. But it was very hard for some time.
Right.
So did we touch that initial topic we thought we would put for this talk? How to build kick-ass teams.
How to build kick-ass teams, yeah.
So can we have that punchy insight of how these guys can also develop some?
Yeah, okay. So, see, a lot of times when I go, I try and take care that you know, I'm well within the business framework because I have a name for just pulling things out of anywhere and, you know, at times logging edgy. But I believe entrepreneurship is actually about playing on the edge. A lot of people who, so if you want to build an average company, you will very easily build it. Let me tell you, there are enough consumers to buy anything you produce, anything. You sell a shoelace, enough market. You sell socks, there's enough market. You make shirt buttons, there's enough market. It is impossible not to make money in this country. Impossible. You have to be dead not to make a money, not to make money. You know, every other way you'll make money. And you know it. I mean, you go out, you see every car is selling. People buy a car and then change their tires 4 times to get the size right. And there are cars which had original this size, they have 4 times larger tires are running on that. And people do all kind of things. So which means anything sells. What is difficult is to build a great company. That is difficult. A company where members will say, team members will say, this is where I want to work. No matter what they pay me. And we know of those examples, right? There are companies where we would love to work irrespective. We'll never ask them a question, what is going to be my paycheck? Right? If they tell that, okay, we are willing to hire you, we will not ask any questions. So how is it that happened? Isn't it one? A lot of us complain about saying that these guys want all the time more money, more money. How is it that there are a lot of companies where we are willing to go and work, no questions asked? That is because they are great companies. So there is a small book called Good to Great. Might be a good read for those of you who want to get more details into what makes a good and great company. But if I have to pull out the best of that, not just that book, but what's my feel on what makes it, is the entrepreneur's passion and excitement. Entrepreneur's passion and excitement, which makes a company different from an average company. How excited you are and how excited and how kicked you are about building a great company is going to determine whether you are able to build it or not. Just like any other plan, right? Your intention to achieve something is step one. That's exactly how it is with building an organization. You decide that I'm going to build a company which is so attractive that, you will never want to leave. If that is the goal, you will pretty much reach somewhere near. You will still have a challenge achieving it finally, right? But you will reach near. You will do a lot of initiatives, a lot of things you will build differently. Like we build flexibility. We realize that flexibility is people want. Do people want rigidity or flexibility? Do people want to every day be marked late on coming late, or they want flexibility? I can come late, should be okay, right? So I said, okay, it's okay. It's okay. They say, it should be okay if I don't want to come on a specific day. It should be okay if I don't want to work 5 days a week. Right? But I want to work 3 days a week. Now you are saying that you are a good guy if you work all 5, and if there's any less, you are a bad guy. How does that work? Right. What if I can achieve what others achieve in 5 days for you in 3 days? Is that wrong to do? I am a superstar. So is that bad? Do you say, I don't want superstar. You want everyone to do whatever work in all 5 days only. So you can finish in 3 days, that's bad news. We won't hire you. We want that? No. Right? We say, well, great, you can achieve so much in 3 days, go. And we know that, right? In our hearts, we know. There are guys who can achieve in 3 days what, I mean, a huge population will not achieve in 5 days, in 7 days, never in life. Right? Never in life. So what's wrong in letting that guy work for 3 days? So at Plug-HR, we said, okay, you choose how many days in a week you want to work. So there are people with us who work for 2 days a week. There are people who work for 5 days a week. And you can switch. You can start with 5 days, and suddenly you said, no, I don't want to work for 5 days. Go to 2 days. Again, you said, no, I want to come back to 5 days. Come back to 5 days. There's nothing wrong in deciding how many days you want to work. Does that make me different than other millions of companies which are making it compulsory to work 5 days or 6 days, etc.? Do I have a story to talk to my candidates? Do I come across as flexible to them or rigid to them? flexible to them, right? That's what they wanted, right? So because I could give it, why not give it? Yeah. People want to work, do work from home. Yeah.
What if the people who are working for you are working with the outside world as well, and outside world does not work in this environment? How do you manage this?
Which is that outside world?
Clients.
So what will clients say?
The client might say no. I mean, if there's a meeting with a client has given on the time, and my guy or my person is late or probably is not going also, then what?
So see, what it basically says is that you have to model your business right. It doesn't say that you build a business which requires everyone to work 5 days a week and then ask people to work 2 days a week. Now, that's a difficult thing to do. Right? So, what I'm saying is, it has to flow from your business design. Your business has to be designed for people flexibility. Because if you design your business for rigidity and then you want to offer flexibility, you will not be able to do that, and that's precisely the flaw in a lot of organizations when they talk about flexibility. A lot of companies don't offer flexibility because by their business design they cannot offer flexibility. They have not designed the business for flexibility. People was not the first thought when they were doing business modeling. So people didn't figure in the business modeling.